He's presently serving as lecturer in electronics at Department of Electronics and Telecommunication Engineering at Government Polytechnic, Nashik, Maharashtra. His total teaching experience is 27 years. He is member of Institution of Electronics and Telecommunication Engineers, senior member of IEEE, member of. Dr. Joshi has published 3 books and several other research book chapters and research papers. He is the recipient of IEEE Rajneesh Arora West Research Paper Award in IEEE sponsored IAW 2014 at Chandigarh and first prize for research paper at Institution of Engineers India, Pune Local Center. And recently received Meritorious Research Paper Award in 2021 of IEEE Bombay Section. His research interests include metamaterial and microstrip patch antennas, wearable antennas, mechatronics and instrumentation systems. He is pioneer in cloth-based, that is wearable microstrip patch antennas at international level. Also designed, fabricated and published various cloth-based wearable microstrip patch antennas for different applications at international level. He is well-known researcher and contributor in wearable and metamaterial-based microstrip patch antennas. He has delivered several expert talks on antennas in various international and national level research and technical institutes of state and central government organizations. He has designed and developed microstrip and wearable sensors for measurement of various physical quantities. Recently, guided the project on fabrication of capacitors in laboratories of desired design value and certification is awarded to his project by IEEE Mysore subsection. He is also contributing his research in National Education Policy 2020 and Atmanirbhar Bharat. So with this brief introduction, I again welcome Dr. Joshi and hand over session to Dr. Joshi for today's discussion.
Thank you, sir. Am I audible? Hello? Sir, am I audible? Hello? Dear participants, am I audible?
Yes, sir, you are audible, sir.
Yes, sir. So should I start?
Yes, sir, you are audible.
You are audible, sir.
Okay, so good morning to... Okay, I will start. Yes. Good morning to one and all. My dear participants, I am first of all thankful to the director, NITEL Chandigarh, head of department, Electronics and Communication Engineering Department, NITEL Chandigarh, and Professor Balwinder Singh Dhaliwal ji, associate professor, ECE department, NITEL Chandigarh, and the authorities as well as office bearers for permitting me to talk with the participants and to present my work with you. Now, the topic of my presentation is textile-based, wearable, and flexible antennas, their fabrication and testing. And I am presenting some case studies, those antennas which I have fabricated during my PhD work or after my PhD work, because till date I am fabricating various antennas and various sensors as it is elaborated into my introduction part. So I am directly contributing and discussing all these antennas with you. So before going to this presentation start, I will tell you that I am giving you the practical aspects of the presentation of the antenna designs, how to fabricate these antennas, which materials that I have been used and which material is available for fabrication, how to test these antennas, and few case studies I am going to discuss with you. So this is my intention for this contribution. Right now, this is the sequence of my presentation. First, we will have the review of microstrip patch antennas in a brief. Then we will have some discussion on the challenges, what the antenna researchers have as far as industry point of view is concerned, or the antenna engineer is concerned regarding the location where we are using the antennas. Then what are the basic flexible wearable microstrip patch antennas, which fabrication steps we have to follow to fabricate the steps, then different designs we will have, some rectangular antenna, then some slotted antennas we will discuss, and two antennas that I have introduced into my presentation. They are flexible antennas based on the foam, which is a hexagonal antenna as well as the triangular, isosceles triangular based antennas, and basically they are used for circular polarization, that is the CP, where normal signal concentration is not available. Okay, so we will discuss that. Then we will have the some topic on testing of the antennas, how we have tested, and which type of instruments we have used for testing the variable antennas. Then another is the equivalent circuit analysis, which is an important part for an antenna designer, because just we are showing the simulated designs and the simulated results, so nobody will believe onto your work. So what you have to do, you have to show the equivalent circuit analysis. You have to draw the equivalent circuit of the antenna model that you have developed, calculate their values. Here you have to use some microstrip line concepts to develop the equivalent circuit for the respective antennas. And though this is flexible substrate or the cloth based substrate, so there are different problems into the fabrication, like the corrugations or some ups and downs are there into the substrate. So how to minimize these effects and how these effects are responsible for changing the resonant frequency of the particular antenna. And then finally, we will have the conclusion and the references. So this is my tentative sequence, or the line of sequence, you can say, for the presentation work. Okay. So what is my first of all objectives of the presentation? That we will focus, we will know, we will concentrate the design, fabrication, testing, and equivalent circuit analysis of the variable antennas. How to consider the equivalent circuit analysis for a particular antenna, how to calculate their values, then how to correlate the simulated, measured, and theoretical results. Right? So these are the very bird eye view objectives of my presentation. And to whom this discussion is useful? So it is useful for antenna designers, some microwave subject teachers, some researchers, research scholars. There may be some undergraduate students. You can convey this message, you can convey this information to your undergraduate students. It is also applicable for military engineers and satellite communication. Actually, this presentation is some slides are prepared for the professional people, so that's why I have added, and I kept this as it is, so that you can share your ideas, you can give your concept to the working engineers as well as the military people and satellite communication systems. They are also applicable for experts who are working in the wireless and communication industries. So this is the usefulness of my presentation. Right now we will start the basic concept of this. Now, in any communication system, RF communication system or mobile communication system, which is based on 4G or 5G, they are using some handheld equipments to communicate the voice and the data. And for that communication of voice and data, you want the higher or the larger bandwidth, so that in this bandwidth, higher data can be communicated. Right, so in the 5G applications, the application scenario is somewhat different, okay, because they are using some wearable devices, and there actually the need of wearable antenna arises. So this thing is there, but we can start from the lower frequencies also, and these bands are in front of you. Some bands might be discussed into the previous presentations, but just I am brushing up your information. So it is used in the wireless communication systems, that is for Wi-Fi and WiMAX systems of 5 gigahertz band. It is used in the wireless LAN body area network, then medical body area network. See, this M-band is very useful type topic. Okay, so my participant friends can contribute and they can work towards the M-band, that is medical body area network, having the frequency range of 2.36 gigahertz to 2.4 gigahertz. Okay, in the pandemic type of situation or COVID type of situations, you can concentrate onto this medical body area network. Then FCC, that is public safety band applications, 4.94 to 4.99 gigahertz. This is again a license free band where my participant friends can contribute into their work. Then military communication systems, radar and sensing systems, medical imaging and systems. So this is a very limited scope here I have mentioned, but you will find more number of applications into the IEEE spectrums or IEEE transactions, magazines and these things, right? And some S band 2 to 4 gigahertz, C band 4 to 8 gigahertz, X band 8 to 12 gigahertz. So these are the applications band where you can work. My one of the student is working into V2V communication, that is vehicle to vehicle communication. Okay, the frequency range band is again different, but that testing is also affordable and it is available into the laboratory point of view, I am telling. So that testing facility is available into the laboratories, into nearby your places or the cities or the colleges or the research centers. So these are the frequency bands where we can concentrate to work into wearable antennas, right? Then what is basically a microstrip patch antenna? You might have studied into your previous sessions. Just I told you, I am brushing up your information. So in conventional microstrip patch antennas, you are using a substrate. Substrate is a dielectric constant. On the top of that substrate, on the top surface, there is a microstrip patch, which is called as a radiating patch, right? And at the ground plane, there is a copper plate again, as conventional to your PCB, that is a ground plane. So this substrate is a hard substrate, what we are using into your conventional PCB. Now we have to replace this substrate by cloth or by some textile or some flexible material having some dielectric constant, right? Now one point here I want to tell, that is much more useful in your equivalent circuit analysis, that this radiating patch or microstrip patch is going to radiate into free space, and that is called as the exterior region. And this exterior region has some impedance that is called as the free space impedance, and the value of free space impedance is 377 ohm, that is 120 pi. In your conventional circuits, we are considering either 50 ohm impedance or 75 impedance. It may be your EDC circuits or some motors based circuits. In another part of electronic circuits, we are having that impedance of 75 ohm or 50 ohm. But here, the exterior or the free space impedance where the signal is going to radiate, that impedance is 377 ohm. Okay, so this is the another one point that I want to tell, that you have to match your input signal with the exterior region whose impedance is 377 ohm, right? And through the SMA connector, we are applying the input signal that is to be transmitted. Now this microstrip patch, it may be having different shapes like square shape or rectangular shape or circular shape or elliptical shape. And you can modify these shapes as per your requirement. As per your requirement means as per your bandwidth requirement, as per your frequency band requirement, and as per your gain requirement. Okay, so this is about the microstrip patch antenna. And here what we have to do, we have to replace your conventional FR4 substrate or RT-Duroid substrate by either cloth or by some textile material. It may be thin or thick, or you can replace it by means of some film type of substrate, as well as you can use some geotextile of type of substrates. So I will tell you in the my next presentation what type of materials are available and how you can choose the material as a substrate, right? Then what are the design techniques are available into the microstrip patch antennas? So into the patch, you can create some slots, you can stack the substrates. If you want the higher bandwidth, then go for the stacking. See, this is very important where that technique is suitable or applicable. Everybody knows these type of techniques are available, but why you are using that technique, that significance is more important. Some of you might be knowing that where these techniques are used, but as a considering the all the participants are newer into this particular zone, into this domain, it is my responsibility to talk something that how these techniques and why these techniques are used. Basically, slots are used for getting the multiple resonant frequencies, that is called as multiband frequencies, and you can shift the resonant frequency bands as per your desired value. For getting the higher bandwidth, you can stack the standard substrates, and you can stack the substrates to get the desired bandwidth. Meandering is also there. If your space limitations are very stringent and you want the multiband operations, then you can go for meandering. Parasitic loading, because see here, I want to tell all of the participants that basically antenna is a LC combination, because its resonant frequency is f is equal to 1 upon 2 pi root LC. That is your ability that how you are adding or making the combinations of these resistors and capacitors in series and parallel to get your desired resonant frequency. That is our skill and that is our ability, right? So this is there. So parasitic loading near to your near to your radiating patch, you can put some copper line or you can put some copper type of arrangement. So that will load your antenna and there is a formation of the capacitance. So that is what is the parasitic loading. Then shorting pin or the inductive loading, it gives the inductance. It is connected from radiating patch to ground plane. So at the both ends, we have to make the drill over there and the metal wire or the shorting pin is placed onto between these two values and we have to short it so that the inductor will be added. Okay, so parasitic loading will give you capacitance. Inductive loading will give you the inductance, and by placing the inductance at the proper place, you can change the resonant frequency. Same capacitive loading is there. You can use the diodes, varector diodes and tunnel diodes that you can put to have the capacitive loading. Metamaterial loading is a new concept nowadays. So people are using the different configurations of the metamaterials to load the microstrip patch antennas and to change the resonant frequencies. Now, variable antennas near to that, into the bracket, I have used one point that is called as discuss it. Now, we are the pioneer in fabricating the variable fractal antennas. Okay, so in the fractal, there are two configurations. You can either add the material or you can remove the material. So basically, fractal antenna is a multiband antennas, right? And we have used the variable substrates like denim or jean. Yesterday only we have submitted and we got the acceptance of that particular paper. So after publication of this paper, we will be in the position to discuss the different geometries, and I can show the photographs to you also, right? So Balwinder Singh sir is also co-author with that paper. He is basically guiding the PhD student who has fabricated the variable fractal antenna. So these are the different techniques actually that we are using into the antenna technology, right? So first I told you have to replace your conventional substrate, hard substrate, I mean to say PCB like substrate, by cloth based substrates or textile substrates. You have to choose your radiating patch, you have to choose your ground plane. One factor here I want to tell you, in the ground plane you can make the slots, right? You can create the slots. That facility is also there, and some feeding techniques are there. They are coaxial feeding, microstrip line feeding, proximity feeding. So we have implemented all the feeding techniques into our fabrication work till date, right? So this is the feeding techniques I discussed with you. Now, what are the challenges in front of you pertaining to this particular online webinar or the STC? So all the participants are requested to kindly focus onto these issues and be pinpointed towards your research. First one is try to miniaturize your flexible antenna or wearable antennas, right? So that it can be accommodated very comfortably and very easily into your personal digital assistant devices, your handheld communication devices, because from body it is going to establish the relation with the end equipments. Another is that the antenna should be multiband operation. It should have number of resonant frequencies so that that can be switched into number of frequencies, and the same antenna can be used for number of applications. Another challenge in front of us is that the larger bandwidth, so that the high amount of data or that data rate can be communicated in a wider manner. Then the antenna should have the higher gain, directivity should be large. Another is that the antenna should be easily interfaced, or it can be embedded with the RF circuitry, so that we are calling it as basically a footprint. Footprint means, let us take the example of mobile your mobile handset. In the mobile handset, the manufacturer will give you some space that is called as the footprint, and it is a stringent space. Within that and that only space, you have to accommodate the antenna with the proper design, right? They will not give you 1 mm more space to accommodate your antenna. You cannot say that, no sir, it is not possible to fabricate the antenna within this strict place. No, they will not allow you. That is the basic challenge for an antenna designer, that you have to be stick up, be stringent with the space available to you by the devices. See, we are not fabricating the antennas at a random manner. We are fabricating it depending upon the space available for you into that particular equipment or the device. So this interfacing is very important with the RF circuitry to that with the space availability. Then the antenna should have reconfigurable. So there are different reconfigurable switches are available. They are called as the MEMS switches, micro electromechanical system switches. Okay, or you can use your ordinary diodes. MEMS is somewhat tedious, and it is not possible to fabricate into our laboratory. So we can go for some diodes, our tunnel diode or another diodes that you can use, varector diodes. These diodes you can use to get the reconfigurability so that the antenna can be switched from one frequency to another frequency. Okay, the antenna should be reliable, and another is that it is a conformable. Okay, just take the example of your thigh, or take the example of shoulder. If you are putting the antenna onto that shoulder, then the shoulder shape dimensions are changing from person to person or user to user. So the antenna performance should not be affected by that bending effect. That's why the antenna should have a better conformability without affecting the resonant frequencies, and the antenna cost should be very low. So these are the different challenges are there in front of the antenna researchers, and we have to accept these challenges or some limitations, and we have to overcome this through our designs by using various geometries and configurations. So these are the challenges I placed in front of you so that we can think into that direction. Okay. So these variable antennas, actually now we will talk actually. Now, can we replace this your PCB type of substrates or your hard substrate by using some cloth, or whether the user can carry your antennas with you? So yes, you can carry. Now, one point here I want to tell, in the last week, I was invited to talk into some IET forum for the researchers and for the defense people. So one point nowadays, the Indian government and the Indian defense ministry is thinking that wearable radars. So they asked me, sir, is it possible, and we are working into this, can you contribute? So I told them, yes, I will contribute, sir, in this particular work, right? So you have to be very choosy and very specific that why you are doing this and where it should be applicable, right? So nowadays, you after 2-3 years, you may find that our soldiers and our military people are carrying the radars into their uniforms or into their caps and helmets. So nothing will be new after that. So this type of technology will definitely support to their contribution and to their noble work, right? So here I want to tell, the cloth is not only for the protection of the people. They are not giving you your social status or that will not identify only your occupational differentiation. Yes, he is a driver, or he is a soldier, or he is a teacher, right? So this will not be only the nowadays status. This will be now not the status of the cloths, but the cloths are nowadays used as a substrate to design and develop the antennas. Okay, it is there. We can have some protection against your ultraviolet radiations, infections, then hazardous situations. You will get the protection, no doubt. In addition to that, we have to use these cloth materials as a substrates, right? So now we will discuss what is basically a cloth-based antennas or the substrates. Okay, have you got the points what we discussed till time? Yes, any of my participant friend can contribute. Yes, you are getting the points.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Right. Okay. Should I continue?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Thank you. So basically, these handheld communication devices and body-centric communication devices, we are using in day-to-day communication. Okay, if you will go to a hospital, nowadays the doctor is not going to touch the body or the organs of the patients, right? In such a cases, you can use the wearable antennas. And basically, these wearable antennas, they are used in the body-centric communication, and they are used to establish the on-body communication and off-body communications. Right. So this is not only medical. One application I discussed with you, you can have the wearable computers. In the next point, I have listed some applications and systems where you can use the cloth-based antennas. So you can use into your flexible mobile phones, tablet computers, smartphones, public safety equipments, firefighting equipments, right? Biotelemetry sensors, even the soldiers who are surveilling or monitoring the airports or the bus stands or railway stations, they can use these type of antennas, right? So into the last month, I have fabricated one wearable inductor, right? Inductor I have fabricated, and that is used as a sensor, and our farmer can use it. So this technology is now not only limited up to the antennas. You can use these substrates, these materials for developing the sensors also. Here, I have the two intentions to discuss with you. First one, as a antenna, it is a foremost with respect to your topic or the webinar. And second one is, you can also think as a sensors into another way, right? Now, these antennas may be worn under the body or under the cloth, okay? Then they may be inside the clothing or over the clothing of the wearers. But you should be very specific that the antenna should be very compact. It should have higher gain. It should have lighter weight. And these antennas should be, as much as possible, try to keep it into the hidden configuration. So hidden antennas is the required, and it should be the integral part of the clothing of the wearer. So these are the few concepts that we should know about the wearable antennas, right? And you have to, first of all, keep in mind what type of application I have to run by using these antennas. So these antennas are now used as a antennas or the sensors into your Internet of Things, 5G networks, where wireless connectivity can be established at the designed frequencies, what I have discussed into the second or third slide. Okay. So this is about the discussion about the wearable antennas. Now, these are the different frequency bands: WLAN, Wi-Fi, WiMAX, then body area networks, M-band, medical body area network, just I told you, and this band is there, then Bluetooth, HyperLAN, public safety band, ISM band is also widely used, WLAN 5 gigahertz, and vehicular band 5.8 something gigahertz, that is also nowadays used in V2V communication or C2C communication. C2C means car to car communication, or V2 means vehicle to vehicle communication. So where the people can think to design the antennas, and this antenna can be a part of or can be integrated into the seat covers, into the glass of the car. so that glass can be used as a substrate, right? So these ideas should be clicked, what type of material can be possible, right? So these are the different cloth based or the textile based substrates and the flexible substrates, what the people have used. Some 3-4 configurations are from our side. That is my contribution, right? See, the soldiers are there, some small kid into the button or onto the body. You can put some antennas, then embroidered antenna. I tried the embroidered antenna in the few years back. So the embroidered antenna I fabricated at my home using your copper mesh, right? Then at the bottom, if you will see, there is a hexagonal antenna which is fabricated onto your foam, right? So you can use the high density foam or the foam available at your laboratory or your place, right? So microstrip line feeding, first right side, the soldier pocket, soldier uniform pocket is shown where the microstrip line is used. Okay, at the bottom, the athlete has the antenna. It is a body worn antenna. So this is another application, right? Into the dressing or into the shoulder of a soldier. So that I have shown these antennas we have fabricated into our laboratory at Chandigarh, right? So these are the different applications and some of the photographs I took from transactions or some are my contributions. They are added into this particular slide. So at least you will get the feel, the application scenario, and the insight of the antennas pertaining to cloth-based substrates or the textile substrates. Right. Now, what are the different 5G technologies? I will brush up to this thing. So these wearable antennas, they are used into Bluetooth technology, then ZigBee, some 802.11a protocol you can use. So we have to also focus on to these protocols, which protocols are available. One thing I want to tell here, that some of the people might be knowing, but it is my duty to tell you, now there are protocol analyzers, like your site analyzers or network analyzers, protocol analyzers are there. You have to connect your antennas to the socket provided, and that analyzer will tell you, yes, it is following which type of protocol. If it is not following any protocol, it will just deny the application of this antenna. Okay, so that we have to keep in mind, that we should be very stringent and very specific to the application of the antenna. Another is, you can decide the distance of communication, less than 10 centimeter, less than 5 kilometers, or less than 100 kilometers. Accordingly, you have to choose your band of frequencies and applications as well as the protocol. Okay, so the people are also working on WWAN, that is wireless wide area network, low power wide area network. So you have to choose. So the review, I have taken the diagram that is mentioned into the bottom of the that particular slide, from where you will get the more details of the frequency bands. Okay, now different applications where you have to be focused. Everybody says that I have to fabricate the antenna, I have to work with the antennas, but first and foremost thing is that you have to be specific with some applications. Okay, if you will see the sector diagram of this particular slide, which is in front of you, there are different applications, that is light embellishment, decorative displays, personal applications, interactive group applications, sports person, physiological monitoring. Okay, then another is the rescue applications, military applications. In every application, this wearable antenna is used. So it is used in ECG analysis, ECG signal pickup, EMG signal pickup, body augmentation, right? So these are the different applications where you can use. Also, you can use this antenna into your industrial applications. You can pick up some physical parameters and you can transmit it towards the PLC, programmable logic controllers, or your SCADA system in a wireless way. Okay, that is your industrial four. Industry 4 concept here you have to use. Okay, so that is, the antenna is not only limited for this thing, for communication applications only. You can use into industrial applications. So one or another day I was discussing with Balwinder Singh sir, so we had that discussion. Yes, we can do thing we can do work on to some sensing of the physical quantities. So we have developed some wearable sensors also for sensing some physical quantities. Okay, so and you can interface it with some antenna and you can transmit. Okay, the sensor can also be an antenna. So this is nowadays the concept. Compactness is much more important. So these are the different list of applications. And this is the interfacing, how you can interface your wearable antennas. So you can put it onto the body to communicate your body parameters. Just now I told you ECG, EEG, right? You have the mobile phone or through the Bluetooth technology, you can communicate your all the body parameters, right? Or your even your voice also or video also to this particular base station and through the antenna and the server, you can communicate your information to the longer way. At the bottom side, some diagram, block diagram is given where you have to interface your antenna. So there is a RF front, which is shown by the dotted block block. So there is a transmission and a reception module. And at that start, we can connect this antenna. And that is nothing but the interface of wearable antenna with the RF circuitry. So that's why I was telling that some space will be given or may be given by the end equipment designer who will assign you the specific space. And for that space dimensions, you have to design and develop your antenna, right? And then there is a microcontroller, or you can have your dedicated embedded system, or you can use the Arduino type of these things, and you can start your communication. So where you can connect your flexible antenna or wearable antenna. So this is the entire background for this particular antennas. What is wearable antenna, how it should be, where it should be used, which parameters are to be considered, where it is located, why it is located, that part we discussed. Now we start actually how to design, how to develop this particular wearable antenna. I told you that you should be very application specific. Any antenna researcher, any antenna designer should be choosy. I mean to say, this is my very clear cut concept nowadays, that we should be very choosy. Choosy because depending on your antenna performance, your communication quality will be there. So nothing to contribute much more into that embedded system and microcontroller. Okay, they are very rigid and very in pattern. Question comes to the antenna, how it handles your much and heavy data, and how this data can be communicated through the available bit rate. Okay, so embedded system and image processing, these people, they are working into their target area. We have to target our antenna so that much more data can be communicated through our antenna, because your efficiency and performance of the communication of the information depends upon antenna performance, right? So this is the background for you people. Now, what are the requirements for the substrate? Now you have to change the complete substrate. Some of the participants might have fabricated some antennas based on this thing, wearable or cloth based. So this is the information for all the participants, that you can use some natural material or synthetic substrate materials. And for this material, you have to think its thickness, right? Or you can say the height of that substrate, then dielectric constant, that is the epsilon R, its conformability, how it can be bent, that is called as the bending moment actually. So that decides your flexibility or conformability. Then the substrate should be wrinkle free and it should be lightweight. And for fire applications or for this thing, firefighting applications, the substrate should be, as far as possible, it should have fire resistant. So these are the very general requirements that everybody has to consider for choosing the substrate in antenna design. So there are different substrate materials. Balwinder sir told me, sir, discuss the different types of substrates with our participants. So I have listed these some of the substrates for you. So polyester, we use the polyester material as a substrate, which is a wrinkle free, right? It has different characteristics. Mechanical, it should have good mechanical support. It should be inexpensive. right? So polyester is very commonly available in every house. I will say polyester is available, so you can use this polyester. Only part is there that you have to stitch that particular substrate. So that part we will discuss when we will talk on the antenna. Then geotextile, it is a polypropylene material. It is available readily. So standard thickness you will get, standard dielectric constant you will get, and it is very stable substrate as far as the bending is concerned. So bending don't have any effect onto the antenna if you are using the geotextile material. Some Bombay based company Techfab, they are providing this geotextile or polypropylene material. Mostly civil engineering department or civil engineers, they are using the geotextile material or polypropylene material into their water engineering or into their water distribution. So this is a geotextile. Then normal jean pant, what we are using, so you can use jean as a substrate. Then Teflon you can use, Nomex, then liquid crystal polymer, that is the LCP, and some fleece fabrics can be used. People are using variety of nowadays the substrates. Okay, so this is about the list of the substrates. Now after choosing the substrate, it is our responsibility to have the proper radiating patch as well as the ground plane. So the ground plane and the radiating patch, it may be fabricated, it may be manufactured by using some copper foil, and this copper foil is like your cello tape, which is adhered or which is fixed or which will be pasted onto the substrate, right? So copper foil you can use, copper mesh like your wire, fine copper wire you can use, and basically it is used to design and develop the embroidered antenna. This embroidered antenna is widely used into the surveillance for monitoring and for safety of the airports or some shopping malls or some bus stands or railway stations can be monitored by using this type of antennas. Conductive spray, it is the spray like our scent what we are using in our daily applications. So conductive spray, it is a copper type of material with some gas. Just you have to press that knob and the copper will be deposited into the given portion. Then copper with the rubber, that is the conductive with some nanoparticles. Then copper paint, that copper paint I used, copper paint is available into the Dombivli in Mumbai. So some one or two industries are there, they are providing the copper paint as well as aluminium paint. So that can be used, but it should be a controlled temperature process. Otherwise, the color cracking will be taking place. Okay, so the copper paint is there. So these are the conductive layers that we can use. Now this is a list of different fabrication steps that we can opt, we can adopt. First of all, decide the applications. Go for numerical modeling of the antenna. Whether you are using rectangular antenna or circular antenna, or if you are doing some meandering, or if you are adding some shorting pin or some parasitic loading, then accordingly you have to use the equations. For the standard antennas, design the antennas for particular resonant frequencies, and it is our responsibility to choose the antenna geometry, whether it is circular or triangular, whatsoever it may be, with its dimensions. Use the simulations. Electromagnetic simulator can be used, like your IE3D or HFSS or CAD-FICO or Microwave Studio, whichever is available at your end, you can use these simulations, right? Then prepare the cloth based substrates. If it is readily available, then no problem. Otherwise, you have to take the dimensions of the substrate, use the sieving techniques for that. Everybody, we have the sieving machine at our home. Okay, we have the vernier caliper we have into our laboratory, so we can measure the thickness and we can fabricate or we can prepare the substrate. Okay, cut the shape from the copper tape by using CNC machine technique or by using simple cutter. You cut it and stick the copper tape or foil onto the substrate. Connect the SMA connector, right? So these are the very general fabrication steps that everybody has to follow to design and develop the wearable antennas. So this is the first metamaterial antenna that I want to show you. So this is metamaterial embedded wearable antennas, right? So the green color, just see the figure number, photograph number A, where the green color shows the substrate of the wearable antenna, which is a polyester substrate. I have sieved this particular substrate at my home. Okay, we will see the dimensions into the next slide, right? And one target you have to keep, try to minimize the copper material as much as possible, because everybody now know, because this is, I think, your fourth day of this training center or of your training. Okay, and some might be knowing, those who are teaching the microwave subjects or the antenna based subjects, if you are reducing the antenna size, then its resonant frequency goes on increasing. So which is not application specific, right? So that is the trade-off we have to find out. You have to reduce the metal portion, you have to reduce the size, as well as you have to achieve the lower frequencies. So these concept you have to implement. So here we tried that. We have tried to reduce the copper material from the copper tape, right? And the resonant frequency is reduced. How it is reduced, that we will see. So on the right side, on the top, there is a soldering. So that is nothing but the feed point of the antenna, right? And at the B side, there is a ground plane. And from the ground plane, the SMA connector is soldered. And at the radiating patch, the connector point is soldered, right? So in between these two, there is a dielectric material, which is a substrate, right? So this antenna is fabricated for 802.11a, that is wireless local area network applications. So we should have some protocol in front of you, as well as we should have some application before you for which you are developing the antenna, right? So these are the geometrical parameters of this antenna. This is the geometry. Basically, it is a rectangular microstrip patch antennas into which I have created the slots, and the substrate is polyester of the thickness 1 mm with its dielectric constant 1.39, copper tape I used 0.1 mm, and the antenna is fed at 11 mm in the X direction and 7 mm into the Y direction. So this is a feed point. So all these representations are must into your geometry. Your geometry should show the ground plane, show the radiating patch where the antenna is fed, and what is the size of every dimension that you have to mention, and which formula you have used. So LR is equal to C upon FR into epsilon E. This concept I used to decide the length of this rectangular patch. Then I have created some slots into that, right? So this is the slotting technique. Then this antenna is resonating at 9 gigahertz. Its reflection coefficient is at 8.97 gigahertz. Then I have placed the metamaterial split ring. See here, there is a split ring I have placed into the square slot. So square SRR is there. So some capacitive loading will be taking place, right? And that reduces the resonant frequency of the antenna. And the antenna is resonating at 5.10 gigahertz with the good matching up to minus 25. So here IE3D simulator is used. So it gives a good matching by simulation way. Then the antenna is fabricated as I have seen into the first photograph. Then the measurement is done. See, first is your bird sight analyzer we have at our Chandigarh laboratory, or you can use any vector network analyzer, right? To this vector network analyzer, the antenna is connected, which is placed onto the white paper, right? And it shows its reflection coefficient or the return loss matching, right? It is giving a very good matching, around minus 30 something. So this type of reflection coefficient or return loss measurement, then it is placed into the anechoic chamber for this thing, radiation measurement. So from the rear side, there is a horn antenna, and at the rear side, this particular antenna is connected to the holder, right? So this is the radiation pattern. So this antenna gives a very good gain. It is around 4 dBi something. So this is a better antenna that I have fabricated into my PhD work. So that is in front of you. You have to show the gain into the elevation way as well as the azimuth way, right? Now bending effect we have analyzed. one or another day, my supervisor, respected professor Dr. S.S. Patnaik sir, told me, just check its bending effect, how it adversely work when it has been bent onto the human body. So you cannot use the human body directly as per as Supreme Court orders and ethics are concerned. You cannot put the antenna onto the body and you cannot test it. Hence, the body equivalent parameters I used. Here I use the PVC pipe, which is cut into two different dimensions of 54.5 mm and 44.5 mm. So it is just like a thigh of a human being or shoulder of a human being onto which the antenna is placed. So it has been bent artificially. See the photograph when it is interfaced with the PC, right? Sorry. And the measurement have been done. So these are the measurements, how the antenna is behaving up in the bending conditions. So we have not seen any adverse effects onto the antenna performance when it is bent. So in this way, you have to check the conformability of the antenna. Okay, bending effect of the antenna. Okay, so somebody can use any other shapes depending upon the application where the antenna is to be placed. So this is the bending effect analysis. These are the applications. It can be used into the shoulder of a soldier or a security person, or can be placed onto the cap of an athlete. Okay, so this is the positioning of the fabricated antenna. This is the second antenna that I want to discuss with you. This antenna has some changes. What I have done that I want to show. Here I used the interdigital capacitor that is called as the IDC. So the importance of IDC, it is published recently into the IEEE Bombay section newsletter. So I have published one article titled as an interdigital capacitor, a multipurpose electronic component as a microstrip patch antenna and as a sensor, right? So this component has a very good beauty. So this antenna, this component can be connected with any antenna to tune its resonant frequency. Okay, so this is there, and this antenna has been presented into the Indian Antenna Week, which is held into Chandigarh in 2014. Where I got the IEEE Rajnish Arora Best Research Paper Award. Okay, the objectives for this work that we try to get the two bands into this antenna. So these two bands we got, first one is the public safety band, 4.94 gigahertz to 4.99 gigahertz, 802.11a band, and WLAN 5 gigahertz applications. So this is the procedure, common procedure methodology we have adopted. But slight change I have done that I have connected an interdigital capacitor to a rectangular microstrip patch antenna. Okay, so see, this is the proof what I told you at the start of presentation, that antenna is basically a LC component. It is a parallel combination of L and C, right? So if you will see the antenna, there is a rectangular antenna having two slots, but the resonant frequency of this slotted antenna is changed by connecting the interdigital capacitor. See here, the different techniques I adopted. Okay, slotting I used, and I used a parasitic loading is not that, but the directly the capacitor is connected to this. Okay, so this is the entire geometrical dimensions for this. The fabricated antenna, A photograph shows the radiating patch, B part shows the ground plane. The antenna is fabricated very fantastically onto the polyester substrate, right? And it has been tested into our laboratory. I will show you the measured results also. So this is the novelty that I have discussed. One point I want to tell here, we have tried to reduce the metal area from the radiating patch and to get the desired frequency. So this gives you one advantage to me that the electromagnetic deposition is going to reduce, because metal portion is reduced. Ultimately, what we people are saying that it has a SAR, specific absorption rate. So that SAR part goes on reducing as you will try to reduce the metal portion. Okay, so this is the novelty of the design, and the resonant frequency is tuned by using the IDC. So depending upon these two concepts, the paper has been awarded actually. This is the novelty. So it is my sincere request to all the participants that try to inculcate, try to add this type of novelty into your design, so that its research paper or patenting or award may be given to you. Okay, so this is my very sincere and honest request to all the participants. Right, so see, these are the simulated results come to our discussion. So it has the two frequencies, FRA and FRB. This is the reflection coefficient. FRA is 5.6 gigahertz, FRB 10 gigahertz. But as soon as the interdigital capacitor is connected to this antenna, FR1 is going to a public safety, that is 4.94 gigahertz bandwidth, 100 megahertz. And second band FR2 is changed to WLAN with the 6% bandwidth, that is 313 megahertz. So with better impedance matching, right? So these things is there. So this is the result in front of you. This is simulated into IE3D. The results are in front of you with IDC and without IDC. So you can differentiate here. What is the effect of IDC, right? So this is the radiation pattern, very good amount of radiation pattern here I got. It is 6.60 very linearly, right? And have the azimuth and elevation radiation patterns. So this is the analytical result, that is the equivalent circuit analysis. See, every person, every antenna designer should know the physics of antenna which he or she has designed or developed, right? Otherwise, it is the contribution of the simulator. The reviewer will blame directly. Okay, what is the contribution of the designer, or what is the contribution of the author? That you have to prove it by using some equivalent circuit theory or equivalent circuit analysis. So we tried, and we are developing the equivalent circuit analysis of various antennas from 2008. So whatsoever it may be, the antennas fabricated by our research group, we have prepared the equivalent circuits of all these antennas. We have calculated the values of L and C involved into that particular antennas, and the theoretical values what we got for that resonant frequency, it is in, or you can say, in the good agreement with the theoretical results as well as the simulated results. So the research, the reviewer wants this kind of different work into your research contribution, right? So see, this is the equivalent circuit. First is that there is a rectangular microstrip patch antenna, which is a parallel combination of RLC. It is shown by RR, LR, CR. This is your rectangular microstrip patch antennas. Externally, we have connected the interdigital capacitor to that. So it has the CP1, CP2 and IDC. This is the equivalent circuit of your IDC, interdigital capacitor, right? And we have created two slots into the radiating patch, right? So these are called as the reactive radiation resistances it is going to add, R1 and R2, with the reactive components, X1 and X2. So it gives the impedance Z1 and Z2. So we have calculated all these values. Okay, now there is a surface current distribution in front of you with IDC and without IDC, and you can differentiate, you can see the nature of the current distribution into this particular antenna, right? So these are the slides I am showing you, which were presented into that particular conference, and then it is nominated. Okay, so you have to calculate all these values. So these are the measured results. The measured results are in the good agreement, right? So the inset shows this particular measurement process. These are the measured results for your reflection coefficient, radiation pattern using, return loss measurement using bird's eye analyzer, and it is fantastically working. Okay, so this antenna is there with its equivalent circuit, but we have observed that the results are somewhat changing. Okay, so one or the another day, my supervisor Dr. Patnaik sir told me, Joshi, iska thoda iska analysis karo internally, what is the effect of this corrugations onto the performance of antenna. So I have created this diagram, verified the particular substrate. So after the studying this, we got some capacitances created into this particular corrugations. And because of this capacitance, the resonant frequency is shifted. So there are two epsilon r here. One is the epsilon r due to polyester, and another epsilon r is from the air, right? So these capacitances we have calculated, and because of this capacitance, the resonant frequency is somewhat shifted, right? See here, 4.94 and 4.85. So some deviations here we got into the second resonant frequency, 5.53 and 5.3, right? So bandwidth is around same, but the resonant frequency is somewhat shifted because of these corrugations. So it will be my suggestion to all the participants that the periodicity, the distance between the two stitches, should be as much minimum as possible, so that there will not be development of such type of corrugation effects. So this is the research we have studied during this antenna performance. So that's why my suggestion will be that go for this thing, radially thickness available materials. That will be good supportive results you will get, right? So these are the achievements and the conclusion for this particular antenna. So these are the applications where you can use these antennas. You can put it onto the sleeve, onto the thigh, or onto the shoulder. So this may be the applications of the antenna. Then hexagonal, this is the work in 2019, very recent work I am discussing with you. Mr. Mandar Doshi from one of the reputed engineering college in Nasik, he is working with me. So we have a very strong research group, Balwinder Singh sir, as well as Dr. S.S. Patnaik sir is also with us. So with his motivation and discussions, we are developing various antennas. So foam substrate here we used. That is what is the flexible substrate, you can say. And we tried to develop the hexagonal antenna for the particular application, and how it is developed, that we will discuss. And here we have projected the circular polarization, CP, so that if there will be a mismatch between the transmitter and receiver, though the signal will be significantly, satisfactorily received by the receiver. And this antenna is proposed for body area network that we will see. So this is the geometry of the antenna where we use the foam substrate, right? And one slot is created inside that, a rectangular slot. So that slot can be placed anywhere depending upon the your requirement or the optimization of the slot. Again, the resonant frequency is calculated. We have considered it as a circular geometry, right? We have calculated its resonant frequency, created the slot to get the circular polarization into that. These are the dimensions are in front of you, right? So this antenna is, if you will see, it is presented into some international conference held at Pune. Every year they are conducting a very standard conference, and this antenna paper is available into IEEE Explorer. It is into PuneCon, that is Pune conference. Okay, so this is the geometry, right? These are the simulated results. It is simulated into CAD FICO, and the axial ratio we measured to get the circular polarization around the 3 dB. If you will say the results at 2.44 gigahertz, 2.46, this is the band we got at the axial ratio of 3 dB. And it is fantastically working for this band applications, right? And we got some review comments, though it is a international conference. The reviewer has been appointed from any part of the world, from any country, and they had given us that try to optimize these slots. So we have optimized the slots into three lengths, because this is a conference paper, so we only use the three value of the lengths. The length has been optimized at the different values which are in front of you. The axial ratio is same in all the cases, right? So this is the parametric analysis we presented depending upon the question raised by the learned reviewers. So this is there, and this is the current distribution around the slot at different angles. Surface current 0 degree, 90 degrees, 180 degrees. Okay, so see, this shows the surface current distribution indicating the circular polarization. Okay, the antenna is radiating very well into the well-defined manner in a linear way, right? This is the hardware that we have fabricated. See, the copper tape is used, foam substrate, right? Fabricated antenna, and below that the measured results are presented. Some variations we got, but after some careful fabrications we have managed, we got the very good results after the measurement. Here Andritsu vertical vector network analyzer we have used for the measurement purpose. Okay, so this is the additional work what the learned reviewers suggested us, we have added into that. Okay, these are the features of the antenna. Now this is the loaded antenna where number of capacitors I have developed into that. This is basically my PhD work which is discussing with you. The paper is available onto the internet also. You can put into the Google wearable antennas and J.G. Joshi, you will find most of my research papers into the Google, right? So A photograph is showing the radiating patch, B is the ground plane. Here T microstrip antenna I used, and this T has loaded with the SRR. They are called as the split ring resonators. So square split ring resonator I used. So it is available into IJMOT. The antenna is resonating for public safety band applications, suitable for firefighters, then police vehicles and offshore workers, right? So this is the geometry. Geometrical dimensions are in front of you. Yes, you can take the note of this, that polypropylene PR30 substrate is used. Its thickness is 1.9 mm. Another thickness are also available, but you can get this substrate from TechFab India, Mumbai. Okay, it is readily available. There is no any corrugation type of effects you will find into this geometry. And the antenna is fed at -7.2 mm in X direction and 0 mm in Y direction. Copper tape is used. The antenna size is shown into the lambda, 0.369 lambda by 0.369 lambda. Okay, so it is just like a square type of antennas. Now if you will see the split ring resonators at the slot, there is a formation of capacitors. So two capacitors I will get, one capacitor between the two rings, right? So there is a one standard equivalent circuit diagram for this square split ring resonator, right? So number of capacitors are there, these rings has some inductance. So this I have considered all the capacitors and inductors into this particular antenna, and finally I got some equivalent circuit that I will show into the forthcoming slides. So this is the reflection coefficient where there was not any proper matching. So after loading that particular T-shape antenna, after loading, the reflection coefficient is very good, and the antenna is suitable for public safety band application for 4.94 gigahertz to 4.99 gigahertz, right? So these are the simulated results. This is the measured result. Again, we have measured it into our laboratory. The antenna is connected. See, it is connected to your vector network analyzer, which is called as a bird sight analyzer by the company. Its maximum frequency is 6 gigahertz. So these are the experimental results. So some deviations you may find into that, but after proper calibration, you will get your this thing, proper experimental results. So these are the radiation patterns, very good in azimuth as well as aliation angle. So this is the geotextile based antennas. Yeah, see, yes, this is the theoretical validation. So theoretical validation is important. I have developed the complete equivalent circuit of the proposed antenna. See, there are four inductors, two for horizontal T part and one for vertical T part. Okay, so LVR and LHR, that is the vertical and horizontal inductors, and this inductance part is loaded with the SRR, and these SRR has created some mutual inductance. So we have calculated the mutual inductances also. Okay, so it is not always that the mutual inductance is to be rejected every time. No, sometimes mutual inductance is favorable. So we have used the favorism of this mutual inductance, right? Sorry. And the mutual inductance has been calculated. Every value of the capacitor and inductor is calculated by using microstrip lines. Here I want to tell you, Filiberto Bilotti in 2007 IEEE transaction paper, he has, that research group has 2-3 papers continuously. You can use their research papers, or for slots you can use Debatosh Guhosar's research papers or microstrip line equivalent circuit analysis research papers and book by respected Professor Raghavan sir to develop the equivalent circuit analysis. Okay, so this is the theoretical validation by using equivalent circuit analysis. These are the practical implementation of the fabricated antennas onto the seat of a car or into a uniform of a soldier, right? So these are the applications that I have shown by positioning of the antennas. Now this is the one antenna that I want to discuss, that is the isosceles triangle. We use the right angle triangle. This is presented into biomedical application national conference organized by NITR Chandigarh in association with the CSIR. Okay, so see, the foam is used, the foam, ordinary foam we used. There is no any very high end or very specific substrate. No, we have used the high density foam, packing foams, right? So this foam substrate is used and copper tape is used. See, this is the geometry of the antenna, right? Again, the slot is created to get the circular polarization. The antenna is fed at the particular point. It has a radiating patch at one end, and other end there is a semi-connected this thing. Resonant frequency is calculated. These are the simulation results with slot and without slot. So with slot we got the reduction in the resonant frequency shown by the red dotted line, right? So which is a M-band application, that is medical body area network applications, with slot and without slot. See the effect onto the current distribution with slot and without slot. Maximum gain we achieved is 8.2 dBi. That is a considerable gain we got in, because the metal part is more, so it is but natural to get the higher gain, and we got it. But though this was our first contribution into M-band, medical body area network, and our another contribution is that we use the foam as a substrate, local foam we used. After measuring its specific parameters, we used it as a substrate. So this is the fabricated antenna and the measured results with the vector network analyzer. Here key site VNA we used. Okay, impedance bandwidth and measured bandwidth is in front of you. That has been presented. These are the features of the antennas, right? Now, another configurations I want to discuss with you, because we have some time in our hand, 10 to 15 minutes. I want to show my work and contributions so that the peoples will be get some insight idea, because case studies we have to discuss. So this is the another antenna to a interdigital capacitor. One rectangular strip is connected, or the stub is connected. So rectangular stub gives me inductance, and IDC gives me some capacitance. Very simple concept here I used. The antenna is fabricated onto the polyester substrate. At the rear side, B side, there is a ground plane with the proper soldering. This is the geometry of the antennas. Polyester substrate, copper tape 0.1 mm. Okay, so these things are there. Another interesting point here I want to discuss is that, see, there is a second band. So because it has a resonant frequency modes, you might be knowing there are different frequency resonant frequency modes. So there is a second resonant frequency
It is not actually the frequency, I want to tell you, because the impedance is not properly matched. It is not showing the reflection coefficient minus 10. But after fabrication, practically, see, it is showing the improperly matching, right? So this type of matching may create the problems into transmission. So we have to suppress this band. So there are different techniques, or sometimes you can use some filter part also, and you can remove this particular band. Again, the corrugation effects we have calculated here. See, the C substrate capacitance is added with some inductance. We have calculated these values also by using some mathematical derivations and some mathematical equations, right? You have to consider the heights into the both cases. Okay, so effects of the corrugations, we have to check on to the antenna performance. There are number of calculations are there. We have to calculate these things. This antenna gives a better gain in both the ways. These are the applications of this antenna in the on-body positioning. This is the in the another way. This is the next configuration where I have eliminated two SRR, and the resonant frequency is changed to 802.11A. This antenna is presented into Indian Antenna Week 2013 at Aurangabad. So slight modifications I have done into the previous antenna designs. This is the geometry. Okay, good matching we got. This is the fabricated measurement with vector network analyzer, good gain. This is the equivalent circuit analysis for that antenna. Calculations of the inductance and the mutual inductance also, we have calculated it in a theoretical way. The resonant frequencies are in good agreement, means the simulated, measured and theoretical by equivalent circuit, all the resonant frequencies are in good agreement. This is the first antenna that I fabricated into my PhD work, okay, where I used a copper sheet. It is not a copper tape, very thick copper sheet I used, and the antenna is resonating at 802.11A local area network and Wi-Fi band applications. Okay, see, just I am modifying the geometry. This is the impedance matching. Okay, two bands I am getting. One is around 5.25 gigahertz and second is around 5.78 gigahertz with very good bandwidth of 13%. Okay, these are the measured results by using vector network analyzer. The antenna is connected. Okay. This is the gain, but the radiation pattern shows some dip because of the irregularities into the fabrication. Okay, so this may happen in some cases, but initial stages, it is acceptable that some minor modifications or minor changes may take place into your results, but it is acceptable, no problem. This is the equivalent circuit, a raw way, very crude method I used because this was my first fabricated antenna in my research work. These are the calculations. I have calculated it later on. After getting the results, I have calculated. This is the application. Belt buckle. I propose this antenna as a belt buckle, right? One point here I want to discuss, that you have to see some array type of antenna, then you have to be more specific for this SAR into the array part as far as the variability is concerned. Now see the substrate, it is just like a Velcro. This is presented into IEEE transactions and propagation magazine in August 2020, last year. Okay, so this is the simulated this thing. Array, four elements are connected and it is pasted onto the helmet. Okay, so just as a case study, I discussed with this conformability. See, the antenna is bent, completely bent onto the helmet. and there is no any adverse effect onto the antenna performance. So this is the conformability testing. This type of testing you can carry out. Phantom models you can use to measure these things. Okay, so this is the antenna where it is placed onto the helmet, as well as the camera or the different devices you can interface with the Raspberry Pi, and the measurement can be done. So what necessary laboratory facilities we need? We need some electromagnetic simulators like I3D or HFSS. We need some vector network analyzers for the measurement purpose. That is your instrumentation part. Spectrum analyzers, some cables and connectors, BNC to N, N to SMA connector, microwave bench, and some anechoic chamber. If it's there, facilities available, then it is very excellent to measure the results. So these are the list of simulators that you can use. I3D, HFSS, CST, just I discussed with you. Then this is a simple flow we published into a format journal. Professor Dr. S.S. Patnaik sir and myself, we have published this particular paper, which is free and online available. My contributor friends can refer this if they need. So this diagram gives the actual fabrication process and what type of steps you have to follow: simulation, then fabrication, theoretical and experimental validation, and all this, right? So this is my contribution I discussed with you. So you use various type of substrates into the fabrication of the antennas, like foam. Then you can use some LCP substrate, Nomex substrate. Recently, we are working on to the graphene substrate, which is a very costly substrate, and its dielectric constant is around 8 to 9. Okay, so this type of substrates you can use in your work, design the antennas, develop the antennas for different applications, prepare its equivalent circuit, verify the equivalent circuit results, calculated results, simulated results, and measured results, right? And come up with the different antennas for different applications. Okay, so these are the some references. You can use our research paper also available into Google, right? So thank you. So this is the contribution from my side. If you have any questions, we can share and we can discuss. I will try to answer your question as much as possible. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Joshi, for thank your you, very interesting session.
Yes.
Dear participants, if you have any queries, you can unmute your mic and you can ask the same, or you can write in the chat. Sir, kindly check chat also.
Yes, yes.
If there is any question, please.
Sir. Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon.
Sir, would you please repeat the books and sources for equivalent electrical circuit study?
Yes. See, for equivalent circuit analysis, you have to use the transaction papers. First one is Piloti, PILOTTI. You can please note down the author's name.
Okay, sir. PILOTTI.
PILO.
Yes, sir.
Double TI, below T. Below T and Vegni, VEGNI. It is a paper of 2007, IEEE Transactions on Antennas and Propagation. Very fantastic research papers are there. This is a very worldwide and well-known research group. They have developed the equivalent circuit analysis of various microstrip lines of SRRs. Okay, so you can use their research papers, or you can use the microstrip lines
there is one standard book recently, Professor Dr. S. Raghavan. You can please note down.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Professor S. S. Raghavan, R-A-G-H-A-V-A-N, Raghavan. He is from NIT Trichy. This is the second one.
Okay, sir.
And third one is, you can use the research papers published by Dr. Debatosh Guha. D-E-B-A-T-O-S-H. Debatosh Guha, G-U-H-A.
So, kindly repeat this.
Debatosh Guha. And one more journal is there, that is called as Progress in Electromagnetics Research, PIER. PIER. Okay, into the PIER, you can refer the research papers of J.A. Ansari, A-N-S-A-R-I, J.A. Ansari. Yes, sir.
Okay, sir. Noted,
and
sir.
In our research papers, you will also find some equivalent circuits also. Recently, we got the equivalent circuit of fractal antennas also. We got only its acceptance on yesterday only. So that paper will be available within 1 month. So you can use that paper also for equivalent circuit analysis. So these are the references for equivalent circuit analysis. Any other question? Hello?
Dear participants, if you have any other question, you can unmute yourself and you can discuss. Sir, I would request you to kindly share your PPT. So that I can forward to the participants, and in that you have written your email ID, and I
yes
I'm sure that
references are also there. References yeah. are also there. Okay, Singh sir can refer the references also.
Yeah.
Not
yeah.
just now I told the references.
Yeah. Or they can if candidates after going through your PPT in detail, if they have any query, then they can contact you or your email.
Yes, sir. No problem.
Yeah. Yeah, so, yes. yeah. Thank you, sir, for... Yes, sir.